Hi, I'm Monique, and I recently had a chance to get up close and personal with August Manley. We hope you enjoy learning new things about him. August Manley?
Yes, how are you?
Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, we are so excited to get to know you up close and personal.
Well, good. There ain't a whole lot to know, but we'll see what we can squeeze out.
Oh, there'll be a lot of things to find out about
Perfect.
You.
Good, good.
So, first of all, you came here from the Pacific Northwest.
I did.
What brought you here?
You know, a lot of things. I think probably mainly just being a country music singer. This is a much better place to be than Seattle was. It's a much more receptive audience, you might say.
I can understand that.
Yeah.
I can understand that.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what did you used to do?
Well, I've done all kinds of things. I've played music all my life. But as far as living in Seattle, I was playing a lot of different styles of music. I was a Hammond organ player, so I was playing a lot of jazz and funk, and playing a lot of rock and roll as well, just trying to make ends meet, along with doing my Wayland tribute.
It started up there.
Yeah, I did. It started about 12 years ago, actually.
Wow.
Yeah, so it's been going for a long time, and it's been. I thank God for Wayland every day, because he's been paying my bills for those 12 years. You know.
Now, do audience members realize as a tribute, or do they mistake you for Wayland as an extension of him, as being you're the representative of Wayland?
Well, I think that people know it's a tribute. I do get asked a lot if I'm Shooter or Way or those types of things by people, but I love those guys, and they're great guys and fantastic musicians as well, but no, I'm just, people know, you know, I try to make it pretty known that it is a tribute to Wayland, you know, and I think it's important to keep his music out in front of people. I think it's the greatest country music ever made.
Absolutely, your act is great. I've seen it several times.
Well, thank you, yeah.
Yeah, it's
we
very
We even played your birthday party.
Absolutely,
ago,
and I turned 50.
Yeah.
50-50.
Yeah, that was a good time.
It was, that was a good birthday. So, do you prefer to do the Wayland tribute, or because I know that you have a new album coming out?
I do. I've got a couple of new albums coming out, actually.
Yeah. So, tell us a little bit about the differences in artistic
mm-hmm.
abilities. Like when you're creating your own music, it's completely different than doing somebody else's music. And how do those both fit into your life?
The funny thing about doing the Wayland thing is it just. You know, Wayland did all the hard work on that already, you know,
mm-hmm.
so I'm not too sure we've ever had a rehearsal with doing the Wayland tribute, you know, because the music's already there and done. People can learn it on their own. We show up and play, you know, and I've been very blessed to be surrounded by a bunch of very fantastic musicians that understand and get that music and are able to portray it. In doing my own stuff, it's, you know, I pretty much go it alone for the most part. I do play most everything on my records myself, except for the drums and the steel guitar, which I have John Rickard on the steel, and I usually use Gary Brazizi on the drums, or sometimes Todd Burr. For the most part, I kind of have an idea of a song, and I'll write out a structure for, and I'll just play it acoustic and let Gary play the drums, and then all those parts just kind of happen as they happen. You know, I don't usually have too much of a goal in mind when I start.
That's very interesting. It sounds like you're fulfilling both parts of what you need as an artist. You
yeah.
know, you've got something that you're
mm-hmm.
paying bills with,
that
keeps you gigging.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
And then also something that is fulfilling a more artistic part of you.
Yeah, so that's very true. And the Wayland thing, I've just been extremely blessed with that whole thing. I get to travel all over the country and play in front of audiences of thousands of people.
When you do the tribute, you do it with other acts?
I do,
like
yeah.
Willie Nelson?
Yeah, so we, next week I'll be heading up to Iowa to play a show with a group called the Highwaymen Live. And that has a Johnny Cash and a Willie Nelson. I do the Waylon parts, and we do it as kind of like, you know, the Highwaymen show when Highwaymen together. And occasionally we'll have a Chris Christopherson guy too.
Do women ever throw their panties at you?
Well, let me tell you, the median age at those shows is probably mid-70s. So I hope that doesn't happen.
Well, you never know.
You never know. Hey,
women are looking better the longer they are.
Yeah, that's the truth. Yeah, the closer I keep getting to that age, hey, you know, you never know.
Yeah, well, you know, knowing that we were going to come into this, I kind of asked some people, like, what kind of questions did they have for you?
Yeah, all right.
So I have...
People actually wanted to ask me questions?
Yeah. Are hot dogs considered a sandwich?
Well...
You can look at that if you couldn't understand what I'm saying.
I want to know who asked this question. Are hot dogs
considered... It might be the tall friend. He kind of looks like a hot dog.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to have to say yes. I would consider that a sandwich. I had one yesterday.
Really?
I did. It was a Johnsonville cheese-filled bratwurst with one hot dog bun.
Okay, well, I always feel like hot dog buns, that makes them not a sandwich, even though it's bread.
Well, I got to tell you, though, there's times when I take a hot dog bun and make a sandwich in it, like a regular sandwich. Could be a tuna melt or just some lettuce and salami.
Don't you call it a tuna dog?
Possibly, yeah.
Maybe that's what we should
do. Get me a tuna dog. Yeah.
Get me a tuna dog, honey. All right. Now, someone was wondering if you knew why manhole covers are round.
You know, the funny thing is, I do. But I'm the guy that told me about it. I'm just wondering whether or not I'm supposed to divulge that information or not.
Oh, is that what you majored in college?
No. Manholes, no.
Okay. I'm going to have you read
this. We're going to edit this, right? All right. Do you wear your vest in the shower? Well, how else does it get washed?
So that's a yes.
Yeah, matter of fact, my vest is in the shower right now.
Without you?
Well, you know, I had to come here and do an interview, and it needed to wash.
Say you were from Mars.
Am I not?
Well, I don't know. How would you solve problems if you were from Mars?
I don't know, but I got to say this about Mars, because one of my favorite songs by Toto, Africa, when I was a kid, I always thought that the line in it was that there's nothing that 100 men on Mars could ever do. And I thought that was a very reasonable statement. I'm not too sure what 100 men on Mars could ever do.
Okay, so we're in the middle of this COVID crisis.
Yeah.
And
deep in it.
Right, and it's shut down all these people's source of income, performers, and it's looking very bleak as far as being able to make money doing music.
Mm-hmm.
I think all these people are doing live streams, and that's great, and it's a way for them to make some money, but I totally miss watching people perform and all the rest of the stuff that goes with seeing live music. Like, I can hardly wait.
Well, and music, yeah, me too. And music is a vibration, and it's something that should be physically felt from the actual source, not through a digital medium or any of that kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Music needs to get back to what it should be and originally was, which is a way of communing with people. And because music is, like when I was a kid, you know, I'd put on a record and I'd sit there and stare at the record cover
and thought it was cool, and the artwork and look at it all.
Yeah, and when I put the record on, I would listen. you know, and I would intently listen, and I would listen start to finish of the record,
right.
you know. But those days are gone, and music is now kind of the backdrop to everybody's life. It's everywhere, and everybody has it, and it's no, you know, that importance isn't there on music anymore. And music is supposed to bring people together, so I think sitting around a campfire with a bunch of people with an acoustic guitar and singing is a much better scenario than anything, really.
How do you feel about 8-tracks?
I love them.
Yes!
This is a true story. When I was in high school, I had hundreds of 8-tracks. I listened to them all the time. I had everything, you know, like you name it, from Sinatra Live at the Sands to Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon, to Electric Light Orchestra, Kenny Rogers, Waylon Jennings, all, you know, across the board, all kinds of Bach. And I love listening to it.
Yeah, when I moved to Hollywood, we had a stereo and an 8-track player, and we would listen, and it click, click.
Oh, yeah.
Click, click.
Yep.
Click, click.
Oh, yeah. Program.
The Pretenders.
You know,
we're going to be back in just a moment.
We are? Where are we going?
We're going to go and get another cocktail.
Well, oh, now you're talking.
Yeah.
All right. Let's do that.
All right.
The choking kind. Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's Wednesday or Thursday or something like that. I don't even know what day it is. I think it's Thursday. At about approximately 7 p.m., if you're watching this. And
apologize to all you who tuned in last night. We had some serious technical difficulties, but I think we're working our way around it. So this should be all be good at this point. But listen, it's great to be back with y'all. We've missed you. It's been a while since we've had a show. And I think this one's going to be one for the books, I think, or the trash can or something. It's going to be something for something. But this is a special, special presentation of the August Manley Hour live from the Dirty Drummer. This show is very special to me because I have an extremely special guest that's going to be on with me live tonight. And I also have the opportunity to interview another very special person to me who's just been an absolutely fabulous friend since I met him. And I'm going to do got a little clips later on for that when I interviewed Mr. Bob Warren. Yeah. And for those of you who don't know Bob, I hope you get the chance to meet him at some point because he's a fantastic individual and he's been around this town for a long time and he's got some fantastic stories. And I always love sitting down with him because usually the beer and the Jack Daniels flows pretty good and we always have a good time talking. So we're going to have that for you a little later on tonight too. But this episode also is special to me because my guest tonight and Bob as well, there are people that have helped me out tremendously in my life since I've been down here in Arizona, and I'm very thankful for them. And you know, helping each other out is very important. As a matter of fact, last week I had a buddy of mine. He showed up at the house and he didn't look too good. I was like, what's going on? And he told me that he and his wife were, you know, they're still good and everything, but the spark was gone. They're kind of, you know, just nothing's really like that happy or, you know, or like it was in the beginning anymore. And he asked me advice. And well, I don't have a whole lot of advice on that, but somebody did tell me one time that you should always treat your wife like it's your first date. You know, take her out for a dinner and a show and, you know, open the door for her and you know, just compliment her, treat her really well. And he's like, okay, well, I'm gonna try that out tonight. I said, okay, good. And I didn't see him for a couple of days, but a few days later, we ran into each other again. He was happier than I've probably ever seen him in my life. I said, well, what happened? He goes, well, I took your advice, and I decided to treat my wife like it was our first date. And so I took her out for a meal, and we went to a show, and the best part of the whole thing was I dropped her off at her parents' house after the... yeah, what happened to those jokes? So anyway, back to the program. So taking care of people like my guest tonight, whom I love dearly, she allowed me a place to live in her home for a while when I was just moving down here and trying to get my legs underneath me. And she is allergic to cats, but she allowed me and my cat to stay there for a while. It was very much appreciated. And I love her dearly. So we're going to take a real short recess and a little word from our sponsors, if you will. And when we come back, Ms. Monique Faber's here. So stick around.
I can't recall one time in my life.
Get ready for the freewheeling sport.
Super kick, boy, push your knees. Come get in with that. The feeling is freewheeling. The feeling is dynamite.
Freewheeling means you can get options like panel interior, special paint, trick wheels, and more from your Ford dealer.
And we're back. And listen, just like I promised, please put your hands together for the lovely and beautiful Miss Monique Faber. Come on out here, Monique.
Thank you.
I can't tell you how many times I've had deja vu today.
12 times?
I know, right? Well, it's wonderful to see you. You look lovely as usual.
Thank you. It's great to see you, too.
Yeah, and I'm glad you're here.
And I'm glad to be here.
I know. We don't get to see each other often.
Not when things close down. Oh, we got the Dirty Drummer we get to enjoy tonight.
We do. We got tonight. Who needs tomorrow? Wow, let's not do that one.
No.
Well, listen, I was telling the folks here earlier about you and how you were nice enough to put me up when I needed a place to live for a while. And I'm very appreciative of that very much. And one of the things that I just reminisce fondly about often is sitting on your back patio with you and writing songs and picking some strings and you know, a couple of cocktails and having a good time, you know?
Yeah, it's always good to have someone that's like way more skilled than I am to help.
That's the way I felt.
Make things happen.
Yeah, well, you know, that was very fun. And a lot of things came out of that. And well, actually, you had mentioned to me before about the church that you go to.
Yeah, Church of the Holy Cocktail and the Latter-day Drinkers.
That's right. I'm going to have to go get ordained in that.
Right. I really think that we should make it a non-profit.
We should. And I want to know, if you get ordained in that church, can you marry cocktails together?
Yes.
Like an old-fashioned and a martini?
Yes, you can.
An old teeny?
That's right.
So, and at that church, you guys would obviously drink, but what else?
Well, we do a food theme, and everyone had to bring a dish. Like one time we did a deviled egg off, which Tony Martinez won.
Oh, hey, how about that?
And we would, it kind of started out, like me actually playing music started out because the boys wouldn't get started playing. They'd just be like, oh, let's drink and let's eat and let's not play. And then like hours would go by. So we had said, hey, let's learn some gospel songs, just traditional gospel songs. And we would get it started, and then the guys would come on out, and they're like, well, we can do this too. And they would start playing, and then it really evolved into people in our local music scene that didn't play together in bands, but were able to do it in a really relaxed setting. And then projects came out of it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, one of my favorite ones in Phoenix, when I moved down here, that started out of that was Barefoot and Pregnant.
Yeah.
Which went on for how long did that band go on?
Nine years.
9 years?
Yeah.
Oh, Toledo, I did not know that.
Yeah, that was a long time.
Yeah. And I was very saddened when that became no more. But like I often say, bigger and better things are on the horizon. And,
absolutely.
And what are you doing now?
We are doing Lottie and the Lizards.
Lottie and the Lizards.
Yeah.
And it's a fantastic group. A lot of talent in this group. And tell me about who's in it.
Well, we have Honey, a very effervescent front person.
Yeah.
We have Mickey, who's playing bass, and he played with the Grievous Angels in town years ago. And he's played with a lot of other bands. But he's a great songwriter as well. We have Jerry and Marsha, who are both with me in Barefoot and Pregnant. That's and Chris is playing guitar with us.
Yeah. Well, next time you see Chris, tell him I said hi, because it's been too long.
Absolutely.
It's been too long. Chris, if you're watching, hey, how you doing? We need you back on that guitar. Because he plays in my Waylon tribute every now and again. I can almost talk. That's all, folks.
It's a different Chris, though.
Oh, not Chris Orff?
No.
Oh, well, I apologize.
No, that's okay.
I sit corrected.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's good. Everyone has a role to play in this. Everyone has something that they're bringing to the table. And it's really fun and exciting and watching things that maybe I've got 75% of the way done, having them all come together with the help of everyone.
Yeah.
And it's really fun.
Yeah. Well, and that's what it's all about, is that it's fun, you know?
Yeah.
And if you got that, you're winning.
Yeah.
So, and I'll tell you, when was the last time y'all performed?
We played here. It was our first and only gig.
Yeah, and I think that's what I saw that show. It was fantastic. And then all this real quarantine happened.
Yeah, we were set up for another gig here, and then it got canceled.
Yeah.
Because everything, went to shit.
Yeah, well, hopefully this stuff will blow over soon, and we can all come out and watch you perform.
I hope so. I'm really looking forward to it. And I think every musician is really missing playing with having an audience out there. And I miss going to a club and having a drink and being able to chat with people and to just see how people are doing.
Right.
You know, I miss that so much.
Me too. And that's what music is really all about. You know, it needs to be in front of people and it needs to have that interaction.
Right, because doing something just on the internet, you don't get the feedback
right.
that you do when you are playing in front of a live audience.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I miss the bars.
Yeah, me too.
You know?
Me too. It's going to be sitting in
my
room right
drinking.
Now. That's right. which ain't bad either. Yeah.
It's not, but I miss the interaction that comes with going out.
Yep, and so being a musician isn't your day job.
No,
because you have a, I think, an even better job.
Yes, I sell liquor.
Yeah, that's right.
So, run a department at Sexy Safeway.
Uh-huh. Down there where Tempe?
Yeah, Tempe by the college.
Yeah.
So it's where all the beautiful, skimpily dressed people, I get the best service from all the beer reps because...
Oh, yeah, because of that.
They want to look. Yeah.
Well, yeah. What are you going to do?
No. You're young ones. Strut that stuff.
That's right. That's right. Well, my days passed a long time ago.
Mine too.
That's all right. So, you're going to let me do a song with you tonight, aren't you?
Absolutely.
Well,
and it's not, you know, I told you about a song that we had done that I had started off.
Uh-huh.
And you and I started in the backyard. That's not the one we're doing tonight.
No.
But this was also written in the backyard.
Well, perfect. See,
yeah.
That's
all backyard songs.
Stick around. We'll be right back. I'm back with the lovely Monique Faber, and we're going to do a song now, one that you wrote.
Yeah.
Yeah, called Angels Share.
Absolutely. It's
Tell
a part of
angels.
The whiskey
yeah.
that evaporates. And this is actually part of the 52-week club. It's a songwriting exercise where they give you a phrase
yeah.
every week,
mm-hmm.
and this is the one that came out of it.
Well, perfect. Let's try it out.
Yeah.
All right.
Thanks for playing. Every night, the stars guide me back to the arms where I belong. Over hills and through valleys, I always find my way back home. Into your arms they are waiting. Into your arms there's comfort there. Into your arms they will greet me. Not an hour of love escapes us, cause we stole the angel's share. Every day I grow weary, all work and no play, counting down the minutes, searching for your arms and they will greet me. Not an ounce of love escapes us, cause we stole the angel's share. street. A leap and I will fly into your arms. They are waiting. Into your arms is comfort there. Into your arms they will greet me. Not an ounce of love escapes us, 'cause we stole the angel's share. Stole the angel's share. Stole the angel's share.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Maureen. Maureen Taylor, ladies and gentlemen. We'll be right back.
Let it be Lowenbrau.
Congratulations, Big Shot.
Then I suppose you're going to forget your friends now.
Probably.
Recently, I had an opportunity to catch up with a good buddy of mine, Mr. Bob Warren. He's an Arizona native, and he also happened to be one of the best friends of Frank Armstrong, Dana Armstrong's father, who started the Dirty Drummer here. And I always love catching up with him because he's got all the stories about all the times that I wish I could have lived through here in this town, with all the great old bars like JD's and Mr. Lucky's and quite a few others that he'll talk about. But we had a good time. We drank some whiskey, we spun some records, and just shot the shit and picked some tunes. But check it out. I hope you enjoy it. Hey, Bob.
Hey, Jeremy, what's up?
Oh, you know, just walking around the neighborhood with my guitar. How you doing?
Good. Yourself?
I'm good. It's good to see you. I figured maybe I'd come over, chat with you for a bit, and pick a tune or two.
How about a beer?
I'd love one, please. It's a long walk. Cheers.
Another summer.
Another winter.
Hey, Jeremy, how about a little whiskey?
That's a good idea. I'll grab
good.
It.
Good. I know how to do this part.
I got your finest plastic. Yeah, and I want to ask you about all the years before I was born and long before I moved down here. And all these amazing, my hero, musicians that you got to see at all these places.
But I feel badly about other people not having the experiences that I had of watching country music start out in its roots.
Yeah.
And then unbeknown to me what was happening, that it was becoming very, very popular. And in my day, when I saw all the top, like we talked about before, Ernest Tubb, Hank Williams, Merle Haggard, Ray Price, Willie Nelson,
all the greats.
Tammy Wynette, Patsy Cline. And they played in bars. We didn't have concert areas.
Right.
We didn't have big arenas and stadiums and places like that. And there was the country music crowd.
Yeah.
But it was a lot of people. And you could be somebody would tell you, you know, everybody worked and whatever, and it's after work or something. You know, Tammy Wynette's going to play at Graham Central Station this next week. Oh, wow. You go there, no charge, nothing. Just went there.
Had a good time.
And watched Tammy Wynette for 4 or 5 hours.
Yeah, good Lord. Yeah, the greatest singers, all for free.
All for free.
Thank you.
Well, I was the Jeremy. A story came to my mind that includes Dana's father, which
Frank,
very,
right?
Very, very close friend of mine, one of my best friends. And we used to go to a place with a couple of our other friends, a high-end place for us it was, on Lincoln Boulevard, just before you get to Scottsdale Road, called Dale Anderson's Other Place. And they had a piano. A guy played the piano there, well-known here in the valley. And they had a bar around, a kind of a piano bar type of place. And but a high-end place, the people out in that area, you know, the, where they went to drink and eat and all that. Well, you could request music.
Yeah.
And Dave, he, we all knew him, too. He knew what was coming when we came in, what was going to happen. We come in, and he's playing all of these songs for these people that are, they're as far removed from country as possible.
Yeah.
And he knew this song that I'm going to mention, the Crystal Chandeliers.
Oh, yeah. And, Charlie Pratt.
And he had to acknowledge us because we were sitting at the bar and we were a part of everybody sitting there.
Yeah.
And he just, the whole time, he'd just stare at us while he's playing this, oh, he played a piano, playing this music for these people. And it came our turn to request, and Dana's dad, Frank, said, how about Crystal Chandeliers? And he'd play it and we'd laugh.
Yeah.
We'd get the biggest kick.
Everybody else in there probably hated it.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Well, so that's I love Charlie Pride too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. See if I remember any of it. Oh, the crystal chandeliers light up the painting on the wall, the marble statues standing stately in the hall. That might be all I remember. Yeah, I love Charlie Pride. So it's called Truth Serum.
It is the Truth Serum too.
All the stuff's gonna come out now.
Truth Serum, right?
And there was Frankie's place you were telling me about too.
Yeah, Frankie's, that's where I first saw Waylon Jennings, not knowing it was Waylon Jennings. I didn't know his name.
Yeah.
And I had a drink with him, and a couple of years later, they had a... Ron, what was the name of the bar down on the river bottom in Scottsdale Road?
JD's.
Yeah.
Went down there one time, and they had a guy named Waylon Jennings playing.
Yeah.
Said, oh my God, that's the guy we used to see at Frankie's and didn't even know who it was.
Yeah.
And now he's really famous.
But and what years was that? Early 60s?
Yeah. Middle or early middle 60s.
Yeah. Turns out he made a career for himself too.
Yeah.
It's weird.
I saw him in Cave Creek at the Buffalo Chips.
Was that around there?
Three or four, no, this is years later.
Oh, okay.
3 or 4 months before he died.
Yeah.
And we're just sitting there in the bar and somebody says, we got Pat or somebody said, you know, we got a surprise for you. And here came Waylon. He was in pretty bad shape, but he sounded great.
Yeah. Well, he had that voice. That never left him.
Right.
Yeah. And that was... Well, that would have been, what, in 2000, when did he die, 2002?
2002.
Yeah, so that would have been 2001 or something like that, maybe, yeah.
I asked him, I said, you know my favorite song? And I said, Honky Tonk Heroes. He says, as a matter of fact, I'm going to play that, cowboy.
Did he do it?
Yeah, he did.
Oh, man. Yeah, I wish I could have seen that. But I'll tell you what, I did bring my guitar.
Oh, that'd be great.
And I know that you love that song, Honky Tonk Heroes. It's one of my favorite tunes that Waylon ever did, too. It's a Billy Joe Shaver tune that he did off of that record. Down leaving son, I done did everything that needs done. Woe is me, why can't I see
I best be leaving well enough alone. The neolight nights couldn't stay out of fight, but keep a hold for me in memory. Well, there's one in every crowd for crying out loud. And why was it always turning out to be Bob? Where does it go? Because Lord only knows. Seemed like it was just the other day I was down at Green Gables, hogging them tables, and generally blowing all my hard-earned pay. The anorak blues, I danced holes in my shoes. There weren't another way to be. Oh, lovable losers, and no account boozers, and honky-tonk heroes like you, Bob.
Yeah, I love that song.
Where does it go?
Where does it go? I got a squeaky chair.
It's amazing all my stories that are about bars.
That's shocking, Bob.
This pool's a little boring, and I'm afraid I'm going to lose anyway. So why don't we go back to the bar? I'm better at drinking beer and whiskey than I am at playing pool.
Turns out I am too, Bob. Let's do it.
You know, I'm sitting in a parking lot of a service station at 35th Avenue and I-10, waiting to meet a guy, and I got KNIX on.
Damn.
And this song comes on. I thought, my God, who is this? My God, is this a great song? So I went to a gal I know. She serviced jukeboxes and bars and restaurants and commercial places. I went in and I says, I just heard a song I want. She says, there's a new guy out called George Strait, and he's got a song called Right or Wrong. Is that the one you want? I said, yes. She says, they're all sold out. I got two. But one guy I don't like, and I like you better, you can have his, and I'll tell him he'll have to wait.
And this is that one.
And this is it. Right or wrong, I'll always love you.
Oh, I love this song. And this is the one you actually bought back then?
Yeah.
This was like 80-something, right?
Oh, it was, I think
you gave it. Right, but it was like 1980.
Right or wrong, I'll always love you. Though you're gone, I can't forget. Right or wrong, I'll keep on dreaming. Still I wake with that same old regret. All alone.
Came up here in 77. People were still water skiing in the canals. And we had a lot of fun. There were a lot of bars to go to, and we were young. Bell Road didn't even exist. Got here, they'd have boonies, buy three or four kegs of beer, go out north, just north of Bell Road. So now, the only thing we have left, Dana, in 2020, is to come to Bob's.
That's right. That's it.
This is, this, yeah.
Yeah, Jeremy, you should play with
place it. Bob.
It's all about Bob.
All right, we're going to Bob's.
Now. Place we have to go now.
Yeah. Jeremy and Bob.
I'm waiting for the August Manley
album. Who the fuck is Jeremy?
Some time in San Francisco. I spent a night there in the cave. They put a drunk man in my jail cell. Took $15 from that man. Gave him my watch and my old house key.
Well, we're back. Yeah, Monique, hey, that was fun. Thank you.
That was, thank you so much for playing.
Yeah, this has been extremely fun so far. And we had a good time watching the Bob segments. Bob Warren's always a good time. And there's a lot more of that interview. We talked for hours. And I don't know how many bottles of Jack Daniels we went through, but...
Sounds like a good time.
At some point, we may post up some more of that, because there's just a lot of good stuff in there. And that was a fun time, but...
We have some more Jeremy Manley interview, and it wasn't all fun and games and laughs. We had some serious things to talk about, and this is where you're going to get to know more.
Yeah, well, I can't wait to watch it, because I don't remember.
I had a great time.
I think I did too, because I woke up the next morning with a headache.
Well, you know, that happens.
That usually means something good happened.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think I left my beans on the stove. I think they're burning.
Now, I've got a serious question for you.
Uh-oh.
You're up on stage, and the lights are shining on you.
Yeah.
And you just want to play one of these songs you've written from your heart.
Yeah.
And the audience only wants to hear Freebird. How do you handle that? How does that make you feel?
Well, I let them know... I got one free bird for them, and I got another one for them if they want it. That's not very nice. That's not true.
Do you feel different when they're asking for Mustang Sally?
I feel indifferent. I'll gladly play Mustang Sally, but I let them know it's $1,000 song.
$1,000 song.
Yeah. So if someone puts $1,000 in the tip jar, I'll play Mustang Sally.
And do you segue into your own song in the middle of it?
Mustang Sally ain't my song. Whoops. No, well, I'll tell you. You know, the funny thing is, I've never had to play Mustang Sally.
Because no one's ever had $1,000.
No one's ever had $1,000. Well, one of these days, I'm going to pipe up like that, and someone's going to put $1,000 in there, and I'm going to have to know the song. Whoops. It's funny, because, like, we'll be playing the Waylon tribute somewhere, and they'll say, hey, you know, we're a Waylon Jennings tribute. If you all have a Waylon Jennings song you want to hear, you know, come on up and give us a request and we'll play it. And the funny thing is whenever I say that, the only people that come up and request songs don't know who Waylon Jennings is. And they want to hear some, like a Kenny Chesney or a Jason Aldean or something like that, you know. Or they'll come up and they want to line dancing songs. line dance is fine. You can line dance to any song. I don't know, I think they think there's only specific songs that they can line dance to. I don't know.
Do you just lie and say?
I tell them, yeah, here's a line dancing song for you.
Or is this a Jason Aldean song?
I don't want anybody thinking that I've ever played a Jason Aldean song. I don't need that in my life. I got enough people giving me crap on Facebook. I don't need that. Yeah. It's funny, though. You know, out of all the years I've been doing this, the most requested song I ever get is Amanda, which I love that song. It's a great song. And the other one is Love of the Common People, which is a great song, too.
Which song gets you in the heart?
Waylon song or any song?
Let's start with a Waylon song, mm-hmm. and then let's go to an all-time. The thing that makes you feel it all on the insides.
You know, I think, Waylon did a version of House of the Rising Sun. Mm-hmm.
Does it make you well up a little bit?
No.
Oh.
Not at all. It takes quite a bit to get me to well up.
Okay, so what song makes you cry?
Frank Sinatra had a hit with, and it's a song called All My Tomorrows, and it's a beautiful, beautiful song.
Sing a little bit of it for us.
Right now I may not have a thing at all. We're drifting and the laughs are few. But I've got rainbows planned for tomorrow, and all my tomorrows belong to you. You know, it's just a beautiful, beautiful sentiment. The lyric is fantastic. But you know, I think probably Frank Sinatra is probably the greatest entertainer ever in my book.
Did you used to be?
There it is. Well,
Sinatra?
I did spend a few years singing Sinatra. You know, the funny thing is I've done quite a few tributes in my time. You know, I've done Pink Floyd tributes, Frank Sinatra tributes, the band America tributes.
Okay.
And, of course, the Waylon tribute. There's so much good music out there, you know, that that came before me and that happened during my life. And, I mean, I haven't even gotten to any kind of modern music, you know.
Tell me about this album you did.
I didn't. How about that?
Oh, come
that's,
on.
That's a great record, though. That's one of my favorites that Waylon did, actually.
What's your favorite record song?
I've always been crazy off this record.
Look how fierce you're looking here.
Yeah, I'm pissed.
So fierce. Rawr.
Yeah, I wish that was me. My bank account sure would be happier.
That it would.
Yeah, it would.
Hey, right. Let's move on to things that happen now, like an let's talk about politeness in social media.
Is there such a thing?
Well, it's lacking.
Yeah,
it really
it sure
is lacking.
Yeah, people get
and one of my favorite things is to watch this go along.
Yeah.
I get drunk on the patio.
Yeah.
And I just
and you watch all the fights I get into?
Oh yeah. Yeah. When you left we were sad.
Yeah, well I've left a few times, but yeah, it's too tempting to come back. I see things people are posting, and it just ain't right. And I feel like my civic duty, the wine's kicking in. My civic duty to correct wrongs.
And what happens when you correct those wrongs?
Oh, I get told every which way till Sunday how much of an asshole I am. But you know, whatever. I'll stick with the facts. You know.
I think that our loss of ability to speak to one another and actually have a real conversation
Right. Without
being tied to a party is really lacking. We're not able to go over what ideas are and like what idea is best for our public,
right,
for all of us as people.
I agree.
And there are things that we can do.
Right, and I think that we have, you know, Facebook has got to be one of the worst things I think to ever happen to the human race, quite frankly. And one of the things I like the most about it is when you actually find that rare person that you can have that you may not agree with things on, but you can have an adult conversation with and talk about things and go back and forth and I like it when people prove me wrong. I like to learn shit, you know.
Yeah.
I like to better myself and I like to but usually it's just, you know, people just calling people names and acting like they're in third grade on a recess playground or something. You know, it's remarkable. Other people.
Well, I feel like what we're doing isn't working.
No, it certainly is not.
It's not.
It's not
working for our country, and we need to look at some different ways in how to handle these growth problems
Right. That
we're having, and that sort of
change is a very difficult thing for people. And I think one of the things that people sometimes forget or don't seem to realize is that change is going to happen whether you want it to or not.
Right.
There's no staying where you're at. There's no going back to anything. It's forward is going to happen. And so you can either just let that forward tell you how it's going to be, or you can kind of, you know, take the bull by the horns and create that new tomorrow.
Or you can kick and scream and stay in the past.
Exactly.
Which is what I feel like
a lot of people
what's
are trying to do that.
Right now.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, with the digital realm, which we're living in
right now, I think we live in the age of misinformation, or disinformation is probably a little bit more accurate.
We live where everyone is an expert.
Well, that's everyone thinks
everyone
they are.
Is an expert.
But they, what they don't know is that I'm the only one that actually is.
Yes. The bad behavior, and I truly mean rude bad behavior, mm-hmm. that we see on the internet, I understand how that happens. You're behind a keyboard,
sure.
and you're saying things, and you never have to really face the person.
Right.
Like you and I are talking here. Do you think that has bled out into actual behavior in our society?
No, I think so. I think it tremendously has. And this is probably the most ununified this country, maybe the world even, I know I can't speak for other places, but this country that I've ever seen. I get a lot of people, like, you see me on Facebook and we talk about that. And I get a lot of people that ask me why I hate America so much. And what they misunderstand is my passion about it, because I love it so much. And I seriously think that we can do better. And there's no reason that differences should separate. They should actually, differences should bring people together. Well, I look at it this, I played sports as a child. I'm a musician, so I'm always part of a band. And one of the things I learned is that you're only as good as your weakest player. So that being said, it always makes more sense to uplift your weakest player and make them better. And I think that when I was a child, I was taught that that's what we did in this country. But it seems we're not doing that anymore. It seems we're doing just the opposite. It's kind of there seems to be a mentality going around in this country that was like, I got mine, so fuck you,
Right.
And that just doesn't sit well with me. But I'll digress. And I'll drink instead. How about that?
That's right.
That's right. Cheers.
Well, it's been a pleasure having you here tonight, Jeremy. Mm.
August, and it's been entirely
August.
My... It's been... It,
are you having a fit? A lady now?
No. I may throw this wine across the room.
Oh, dang it. I can't help it.
David will never get the red stain off the wall. Tonight. Yeah, it's always lovely hanging out and visiting with her. And a huge thank you to Bob Warren, who allowed me to come over and hang out in his den there and drink his whiskey. We had a real good time. And listen, this is a song I wrote called Beautiful People, and I'm going to sing it for you now. Kick it off there, Darren.
Beautiful people surround me every day. Very happy people, no one could take away. And the smiles on their laughter, I see the love they have to give. Yeah, beautiful people still make me want to live. So much hatred in this world, all the greed and all the hurt. Imagine wealth, endless race, can't take the smile from my face. Oh. Poverty is a an old friend, one that just won't leave. So I'll give to you my happiness, so you in turn can know me. Yeah, I just wanna be. Beautiful people surround me every day. Very happy people, no one can take away. And the smiles on their laughter, I see the love they have to give. If beautiful people still make me want to live. Now, the significant others are going to dance for you for a minute. Yeah.
Make sure you love everybody. We'll see you next time around.